Well, morning. How's that? Is that too loud? Not loud enough? Okay. What do you think?
Well, speak.
Speak. There we go. Right. Is that? Will be better. There we go. Right.
I'll ride it.
Yeah? Okay. Yeah. So, today, I want to talk about names. Actually, names have power. Is it the name that has power, or what's behind the name? Well, I don't know if you've been enjoying the European Championships. Some of you will be thinking, no, about that. I love the football. I just love it. I haven't watched all of the matches, but of course, because there's so much interest from the home nations, I've been tuning in. But I want to think, particularly to start with, about Wales. Now, we know that Wales have got a reasonable side, but made up mainly of players who, in themselves, aren't stars, championship players, lower division players. But there's just one name that everybody knows. Except, do you know?
It's a dot looking.
Do you know Dot? Who's the Welsh player that everybody knows?
Oh, Bale.
Gareth Bale. Absolutely. Yeah, he's a superstar. Real Madrid. And it's the name that, if Wales supporters know that name, then they're hope. Because they know that Gareth Bale will get that. And lo and behold, he scored against England. And it's the name that, when we knew we were playing Wales, that everybody feared from this country. Oh no, it's Gareth Bale. They said, you've got to keep Gareth Bale quiet. That was the secret for England winning. And that's the point, isn't it? With that name comes hope. It's not the actual name itself. It's what's behind the name. It's the fact that there's a player who can do something special. I recently read that lovely story from the Old Testament, the story of Ruth. And it comes after Judges, which isn't actually a nice book. It's just full of turmoil and discord and murder and strife and despair. A time between the time of Joshua and the glory of moving into the promised land and the first king Saul. In between is the time of the judges. It lasted about 300 years and took place about 3,000 years ago. But at the end of that, or in the middle of that time, there's this just delightful story, which starts off badly actually. Many of you will know that story. It's the story of a man who lived in Bethlehem, Elimelech, and his wife, Naomi, and had two sons, just a normal family who worshipped God and followed him. But a famine came upon the land, so they moved over to the east, over the Jordan to a place called Moab, an area. And there, the two sons met women and married them. And then all three of the men died. So Elimelech died, and then the two sons, which left this devout and God-fearing woman, Naomi, bereft, destitute, alone, and with no male protector. And it got to the stage where Naomi heard that there was food back in Bethlehem. We're talking the period about 10 years later. And so she moved back home. A sense of despair and hopelessness. And we know that Ruth, this woman from Moab, decided that she would go with Naomi to a foreign land where, away from her own family and friends, to support this woman who was her mother-in-law. And when they got back to Bethlehem, with nothing, with Naomi not expecting anything from life, what she realised was that they needed food. So they sent Ruth out into the fields to glean. Now gleaning is basically where we pick up the bits left over from the crop. And you might think that, well, there's not going to be much there. And I'm sure there wasn't. Except, of course, that it's one of the laws that God had laid down for people. Something which actually I've had to learn from, I think I've shared it here before, this principle that when you harvest your fields, and actually told in Leviticus 23, when you harvest the crops of your land, do not harvest the grain along the edges of your fields, and do not pick up what the harvesters drop. Leave it for the poor and the foreigners living among you. We could learn from that, don't we? Yeah. I know when pennies are tight and we think, oh, you can't afford to do this, but actually what God is saying is, look, you know, I took you plenty. Let the bits around the edge, the little bits of money here and there, just give those away. It's the Lord. It's meant for those people. We have Greg who comes around to sell us things, and we've got so many cloths now we don't know what to do with them. But it's so easy to resent people saying, they're always coming around wanting to sell you stuff. And I was actually challenged. I said, well, actually, that's not right. You know, we've been given a crop, and this is the little bit around the edge of the field in a good way. Anyway, the fact is that Ruth was going around gleaning. And we know from the story that a man found out, a man whose field that she went to, that he was impressed by the fact that this Moabite had come to support his mother-in-law and come to a foreign land. And so he took pity on her and made sure that she had extra grain. And she said, you know, why is it that you're concerned about me? Why are you giving me this? And this is what the man said. He answered, I have heard about everything you've done for your mother-in-law since your husband died. I know how you left your father and mother and your own country, and how you came to live among a people that you've never known before. May the Lord reward you for what you have done. May you have a full reward from the Lord God of Israel, to whom you have come for protection. And you know, that was one of those verses that I talked about before that just leapt out. The gods that you have come, to whom you have come for protection. She went home that night, at the end of the day, and she had far more grain than she should have, because this man had made sure that she was given extra, and said, actually drop a bit of extra grain there so that she can pick it up. She told the workers to do that. And Naomi, when she got back, she couldn't believe it, because it seemed that for the first time in over 10 years, something good had happened. And she started questioning Ruth about where she'd been and whose field was it. And this is what Ruth said: the name of the man I worked with is Boaz. And this is what happened. That hearing that name, that one name, turned around Naomi's life. She'd had 10 years of bitterness, but that name changed everything, because it awakened hope in her. What she said is this: that man is our close relative. He is one of our kinsmen redeemers. Because the thing is that in the law, the relative had the responsibility to look after the poor and destitute in the family. It's a male relative who had responsibility to act on behalf of another relative who's in trouble or danger or need. And there's a Hebrew term for it, it's called goel, and it designates one who delivers or rescues. So suddenly, we have this picture of a man who is going to be a rescuer. And the rest of the story, well, we know that. It ends with this man, Boaz, marrying Ruth, having a son, and a genealogy. Because at the end of that story, Ruth, this is what it says. This is the son, and they named him Obed, who is the father of Jesse, the father of David. And that was the line going that we travel on right forward to where Jesus came to earth. What a name, Boaz. It actually means in him is strength. And we know that Solomon, when he built the temple, there were two main pillars that supported the whole structure, massive pillars. And one of those he named Boaz, means strength. But it wasn't the name Boaz per se, might mean strength, but it was actually who was behind the name. Boaz, kind, dependable, honourable, but actually just a shadow of his descendant. Because 29 generations later, there was a new name, Jesus. And the thing is, there was even greater hope when people heard the name Jesus. You remember there's an account of a woman who suffered from bleeding. She was ritually unclean. She'd spent all she had on doctors who couldn't help her. In fact, her condition had got worse. This had happened 12 years earlier. It had been going on for 12 years. And then she heard about a man who was in that area. A man called Jesus. And this is what we're told. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. Because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Immediately, her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. It wasn't the name Jesus that did it. It was what was behind the name, who Jesus was. And she'd heard that this was a man who could heal people. And it gave her the faith to go and touch that cloak. She'd heard what he did, she'd heard what he was, that he was a healer who could set people free. And that this man had said that if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. So what do we know about this one who is named Jesus? When someone mentions the name Jesus to each one of us, what do we think of? Do we think of a little baby in a crib? A man in a white robe with sandals? A broken man on a cross? And all those images are earthly images. And there are times when we see those pictures. But actually, when Jesus was on earth, it's just 33 years out of the whole of eternity. And there's a parallel world, which is infinitely greater in scale, in both time and space, compared to the one that we have here. And just as the story of Ruth and Boaz was a pale indicator of who Jesus was and what his role is as a kinsman redeemer, so is the description on earth just a pale image of who he actually is. And we know when we search scripture that there are glimpses of who Jesus is. In fact, as far apart as Daniel, which should be going back 2,500 years or so from now, there he had a vision, and this is what he heard, or saw. I lifted up my eyes and looked, and behold, a man clothed in linen with a belt of fine gold from Upaz around his waist. His body was like beryl, his face like the appearance of lightning, his eyes like flaming torches, his arms and legs like the gleam of burnished bronze, and the sound of his words like the sound of a multitude. might think, well, perhaps just something which he'd seen and was made up, had made up rather. But if we go back, go forward rather, to the time of Revelation, around 2,000 years ago, then what we see, what we hear is another vision. This time, John on Patmos. Revelation is in chapter 1, it says this: I turned round to see the voice that was speaking to me. And when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands, and among the lampstands was someone like a son of man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet, and with a golden sash around his chest. The hair on his head was white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire. His feet were like long bronze glowing in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand he held seven stars, and coming out of his mouth was a sharp double-edged sword. His face was like the sun, shining in all its brilliance. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and now look, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys to death and Hades." Hundreds of years apart, but the same picture, the same image. This is the Jesus that we worship. It's not gentle Jesus, meek and mild. It's not Jesus at the beck and call of humanity and at the ready for death at the hands of the Romans and the chief priests. It's not that. Isn't Jesus. The true Jesus is the one who will reign forever and ever, that actually is in authority over all things, and in authority over us as well. And this is what we're told: therefore, God has exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And that's why, where many people laugh at Jesus, the name Jesus, and what they think he is, and they mock his name, actually, the powers of darkness tremble. That the negative dark side of that other world, that parallel world, this is what they say in Mark 3:11. Whenever the unclean spirits saw him, they fell down before him and cried out, "You are the Son of God." They knew who he was. They know who he is. And they know the power of that name. And isn't it ironic that those who are opposed to Jesus recognize his authority? And so often, I treat Jesus as the man in sandals rather than the Alpha and the Omega. The one who, when all else fails, allows us to merely touch his robe and receive his power when we're in need. The one who will come to our rescue. So that's what's behind the name of Jesus. A kinsman redeemer, not just of one person like Boaz, but of all mankind. And this is what we're told. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. It's not just the name though. The name is a word. It's what's behind the name. Who is the name? And this is what we're told. Whatever you ask in my name, Jesus says, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Because we can do things with his name. That is the authority that we've been given. Back in the Old Testament, David, he knew the power of the name. When he faced overwhelming odds, when he faced that 9-foot giant, Goliath, and he was a slip of a lad, and Goliath had a sword, and he had a javelin, and a spear, which is described as having the shaft of a weaver's rod, a massive piece of weaponry. And he had just his sling and a few stones. David ran at him, and he said this, "You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel." But it wasn't just the name, it was what was behind the name. He knew that that giant had no chance against someone with God behind him. So, certainly in Ashfield, I believe that there are many Naomis in Sutton Ashfield. People who have undergone bad times and are in despair. People who, if we told them about the love of Jesus, would probably spit against the name. They've got the bitterness of disappointment, of illness, of bereavement, of job loss, of loneliness. Circumstances that, like Naomi had in the story of Ruth, have left them without hope and in despair. So what are we going to do? Well, we will not come against them in the name of Jesus, but we will come against the powers that revel in keeping them from coming to know the source of hope, the source of salvation, of knowing that they have life in all its fullness. Because we've got to remember that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers and against the authorities and against the powers of this dark world and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realm. Because what's happening is this: our enemy wants to hide the name. He can't hide the word, Jesus, but he can hide the name, what's behind the name. If he can convince people that Jesus is a man in sandals with no power in today's world, then he succeeded. If he can convince us that Jesus is a man in sandals without power to act in today, then he succeeded. So what we've got to do is change that. It's got to actually tell people that the name, this is what it actually means. How do we win that battle? Jesus said this: Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. How bizarre. He had all power. Jesus knew that the Father put all things under his power. So he got up and washed his disciples' feet, as though that was the most natural thing in the world. And of course it is. What he's saying to us is, in Sutton and Ashfield, if you want to defeat the lie of who Jesus is, then serve the people. Wash their feet. Because when we start doing that, and I know that you do so much in this community, but do more, carry on. Because if we show that kindness and generosity to people and do what God requires of us, which is to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with our God, and remember that when things look bleak, when it seems that we're being overwhelmed, we're actually brothers and sisters with Christ, sons and daughters of God, not his servants. And we have the backing of the name that is above all names, which gives us the right to see the impossible to do the impossible, things beyond our imagining, so that we can say what Peter said to a lame man who was found outside the temple. Silver or gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. And that is what we're doing in this community. We're saying to people who feel that a miracle is needed and they're in despair, well, actually, we have a name. And in the name, just rise up and walk. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your name and your son's name, the name of Jesus. And we know, Lord, that everyone on earth, individuals, rulers, governments, groups of nations, Lord, they will all bow down. And whilst we have been shaken this week with the result of that vote, Lord, we do know that you are the name which is above all names, and you have control, and you have given us authority. But our prayer, Lord, is that in this place, you will help us to give people hope in the name of Jesus, that they will see not somebody who is impotent, but will see the kinsman redeemer, someone who is prepared to help them in their need and can set them free and bring them hope. Lord, we pray for all those Naomis in this place, that their lives will be transformed by hearing just one name, the name of Jesus. For we ask it in your name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Colin. That was amazing, wasn't it? Let's just not get out and just forget what Colin said, but just take up there. I just felt really that we need to take up the challenge, you know, because I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I'm so excited at the prospect of seeing Jesus face to face. But we need to pray for our friends, for our family, for our community, for all everybody around here, that they've got the same opportunity to see Jesus as an almighty, powerful Saviour. Amen?
Amen.
Let's stand and say the grace together. May the grace
of our Lord Jesus Christ,